back as the power for the positive words, the power in the blood. At this time, I'd like for the congregation to stand and let's sing all four verses. Today, this homegoing service, this celebration of life service, and this service, Lord, where, Father, that we pray that decisions and lives might be made today, Lord. Father, we just pray that you will give that comfort and that peace, that, Lord, that passeth all understanding. Lord, we just pray that you will just give that peace that is needed beyond all that we can even understand and comprehend today, as you have in the last few days, and you will in the coming days, weeks, and months, and years, Lord. But Father, we ask you now to just walk with us, Lord. Father, that we that who today want to come and to comfort, Father, Peyton Lee's family, Lord. The ones who want to come and speak to Peyton's friends and all the ones. ones that have gathered here out of respect. And Lord, that we might also not only come to remember Peyton, Lord, but we might just open our hearts up and say, Father, how are we today with you? Father, we just pray now in Jesus' name again that you just bless us and be with us. And Lord, that all that is done here today, Lord, will be comforting to the family today. But Lord, will bring honor and glory to you today. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen and amen. We say thank you today on behalf of the family. We say thank you for, first of all, being here today. For all the ones that are here in the church, for those that are in the gym, and wherever they may be, to get all the people that are here in the service today where they might be a part of the service. The family wants you to know that thank you is not an adequate word for how they feel, for how you have been to them since Friday morning, that you have been beyond any words can describe. But we think that love, that word that Peyton loves so good, describes it all. That word of care, we know that word of wanting to be there for all involved in this time that we're going through today. But for the family, they want to say a very special thank you for being here to honor and remember Brother Peyton today. Thank you for being here to share your love and your support and the concern that you have for the family. Thank you for every act of kindness that you have shown, all the care that have been shown for the family at home and other places where things were done and taken appropriate to show the respect. Thank you for all the visits that you have given today, and all the visits that have been at the home throughout this time. Thank you for all the food, the flowers, every act of kindness. We can stand here and just name them on and on. But the family says thank you today. But most important of all, the gift that they need right now, and they're going to need in the other days and weeks and months, is your prayers, your love, and your support. May you continue to pray unto them and pray for them and let them know that you're with them. Let's please continue to remember Peyton's family in the future and how in a special, special way. But there's a group of young men that the family wanted to make sure that were recognized and remembered. Later, after this service is concluded here, we'll go to the church for the committal of this body, of this shell, of Peyton, because we know his soul lives on today. And there was a group of men, I heard about 27 or 29 of them, went and dug by hand yesterday the grave for Peyton Lee. That speaks volumes right there. That they wanted to do it, and we understand they did an excellent, excellent job in doing it. But the family wanted you to know how much and how thankful they are that you did that. That'll be something that they'll never, never forget. And that'll be a memory, maybe one of those good memories that they need to have, that they can cherish, that something was done for Peyton and also that was done for them. We want to thank you so much for being willing to dig it and all that you did and everything that you have done for them. Today I want to look at some scripture, and we'll be using one verse, but I wanted us to look at it and how it speaks about living. It will talk about a man that went to be with the Lord, but his sisters, as many here today, they were angry with Jesus. They were hurt, but Jesus said that they would live again. Just as we come today and we know that the body of Peyton Lee is here today, we know that soul that lives on forever. That is with the Lord Jesus today, and that we today need to look at our lives and say, Father, where are we at? In John chapter 11 and verse 25, Jesus said unto her, Martha, Lazarus's sister, he says, I am the resurrection. I am and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. We look today and say, yes, we come. And we know that our friend, our loved one, our roommate, wherever you're at in Peyton's life, wherever Peyton is in your life, you know, if I didn't say was, because he hadn't gone from our life, we still remember him. He's in our memory. He's going to be there. That we today, if we come, we know that if these verses, this verse talks about, that Martha, if you go back in the preceding verses, that Martha would say, Jesus, if you'd only been here earlier, you could have saved his life. You could have saved him from going through this. You could have saved him from ever dying. You could have been that one that would have taken and touched his life. The questions may have said, why did it happen to Peyton? We don't know yet. We don't know the results of why and the lives that will be touched as a result of this servant, of this loved one, of this sacrifice, of this one who God is using in a mighty way. The brethren that are sitting beside me today or behind me today believe that in the family I've talked to them, that something and some good things are going to come out of this. That we know today that we have this loss, but we're going to have a gain through what Peyton's life has done. And so that we look here today and know that how that we know that we don't understand it all. But as Jesus talked about Lazarus being raised, it was not about what that Jesus did it for his benefit, but he did it because to fulfill the mission and the ministry of his heavenly Father. And I really believe today that all the good that will come out, we may not ever know all that comes out of this. We may not ever know. But we look today and say, Lord, may we look to your scriptures. May we look to Jesus. And may, Father, may we look to you today and say, Father, that you are the one that will bless us. We'll make some personal comments about Peyton. And I thought about it, I said, well, I could be up here a long time, and I'm not going to do it. I promise you that. I will not do that. But I think about, when I think about Peyton, I think about a Christian brother, first of all. A man that has accepted the Lord Jesus Christ and knows him as his personal Savior. A one that who was not perfect. We know that we none are other than the Lord Jesus Christ. But we look at him as a Christian brother. We look at him as a true, and in the notes that I've got that word underlined and highlighted, because I believe that Peyton was true, a friend to many, many people. I don't know how many of you have gone to the website of Rose and Graham Funeral Home and looked at all the posts that are there and all. I didn't have any look at anything on Facebook or anything like that, but all the comments about a true friend that Peyton truly was. He was such a good person to so many people. And one thing that I saw in Peyton, as being his pastor about the last year and a half, but have known him all his life, to think about that regardless of the age of the person or who they were in their social standing in life, Peyton was a friend. You didn't have to match up or meet a certain criteria. If you were to talk to Peyton a little bit, he was going to talk to you a whole lot more than you understood. Peyton knew what true love was. And we know in those words that he says, I love you. I love you. How many of us today have heard those words over and over? Many of the young adults that are here today, you've heard it more times than a lot of us probably have heard it, even at being in college and being in his life or other ways. But we know that it was a genuine, and it was meant, and he meant every word of it because he loved you so much. As his pastor and his friend, I think about how that he would come to church, and when he would come out the door, you know, Peyton had a few advantages over me. One thing, he was a whole lot taller than I was. And one of the first Sundays, I think, he'd come out, I made a statement. I said, "Don't let me hurt you now." And he said, "I don't think that's going to help." But after that, I just said, "Be kind with me from then on." And he was. But we looked at how that he was one that was very outgoing. I remember the last time I saw him, we were at Cragmont for the weekend, and all the activities that were going on, and he was helping out with so many things and everything. And all of a sudden, I said, "I'm going to move over and go sit with a special person that made a special effort to be at Cragmont that weekend." And I looked over there. Who was sitting right beside him? Peyton Lee. He was sitting right. I said, "Well, forget that. I'll just wait till he gets through sitting with this person that would be classified maybe as a senior citizen." But I'll leave it like that. But we know that how that he was, and that he was so strong, yes, physically. But Peyton was so gentle and so caring as a human being. You know, as we've been said, and as we said in the write-up about an old soul, is certainly a good description of Peyton. That he truly was that. That he was one that, in a young body, but had a lot of older techniques and ways and things and all that he had, but it all worked out good. And it was a good description of him. You know, many of us today come and we see our faults in lives, and we see the loss of Peyton. But we look today at this tragedy we have seen. I'll leave you with this. When we go out of this church today, when we leave the cemetery, may the word be planted in our lives about taking risks. There was a program I taught for years in the schools that dealt with a lot of different issues and a lot of things. And one of the lessons that I taught, and even when in training, was a lesson about taking risk. I thought that would be the easiest lesson in the world. But one thing that I want you to remember today, I want you to remember this. When we are about to take a risk, whatever it might be, when the peer pressure comes in, when the temptation comes in, when a person tries to get us to do something and we just say, "Really, do I need to do that? Would that be right?" A lot of times when we take the risk, that we need to look and say, "What's the consequences? What could happen as a result of me taking that risk? If what can happen for me taking that risk? Can it hurt me? Hurt someone I love? Can it take my life? Can it change my life forever?" And I look at it and say, that risk is not worth taking. Even though I might not be liked as much at that time, but that I still say no to that risk. And today I would say, look at Peyton's life. Look at what we've all gone through with, even just the last few days. And say, "Lord, how can it strengthen me today? How can it strengthen me today to be a better person today?"
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste, glory divine. There's salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, ring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Praising my Savior all the day long.
As has already been stated today, we've gathered this afternoon in the presence of a holy and amazing God to celebrate the life of an individual who's gone way too soon. We're gathered here today with Jesus. We're here today in His Spirit in one accord. We're here today as our hearts break and our feelings are crushed. We sit here emotionally dispirited. Our souls are disappointed. Our lives are overwhelmed. Our moods are distraught. And questions are abounding all over the place. And it's in moments like this that the family members and we as friends of Peyton Lee are forever changed. It's in moments and times like this that our lives are challenged. We all ask the question to God, why? We all ask the question, why now? What's this timing? What in the world is going on? We ask the question, I don't understand, and how can this be? I've even heard some people say this is the worst nightmare ever. But I want to remind you with some great words today that I read years ago that are so true. And I want you to listen to this today. If you don't take anything away, listen to what I'm about to say. The reservoir of God never runs dry. And God always gives enough strength for your next step. The reservoir of God never runs dry.
Amen.
And He always, in Jesus, gives us enough strength for that very next step. I praise God today that in our times of weakness that Jesus is here. And Jesus is with us today. He's available to you, my friends, day and night, night and day. All of us to give us this divine strength for the next steps and the next seconds and the next days and the next years and the opportunities in life. He gives us the strength for these next steps for prepared people for that journey home. I can't stand here today and even in a moment like this not thank Jesus. And can't thank Him enough for leaving the portals in the glory of heaven and coming to this earth to give His life as a living sacrifice for you and for me and for Peyton Lee. And I want you to know today, folks, that in the midst of the hard times and the mountaintop experiences, that Jesus is your dearest friend. He promises to never leave or forsake anyone at any time. And that is, as Alan Jackson just saying, blessed assurance that you and I can rely. I'm thankful that in God's Word we read of God's agenda, because God's agenda is this. Mankind messes it up at the very beginning of Genesis. And from that point on, God is on a strategic journey and an agenda of rescue to bring you and me back in Christ through His death on the cross at Calvary in atonement, back at one with Him. You see, when we take one step toward God, Jesus is running right straight toward you. And I'm thankful today that even in this time, that we read the teachings and the scriptures for our application and hope. We give God glory and we thank God that He pats us on the back when we get things right. He steps on our toes when we make mistakes and get things wrong. But He is full of grace, and His grace covers it all. We're here today to celebrate a life well lived, an individual whose positive traits and characteristics and love for God, faith, family, and our community will carry on. The psalmist offered these words years ago. I lift up mine eyes unto the hills from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord which made heaven and earth. Be glad in the Lord, he says, and rejoice, ye righteous. Shout for joy, all ye that are upright in heart, and blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and whose spirit there is no God. But blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. The Apostle Paul was inspired to write those beautiful words sent from the very throne of heaven that read, we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. What should we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? In all things we're more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I'm persuaded that neither death, life, angels, principalities, powers, things present or things to come, nor height, depth, or any other creature shall be able to separate us or separate Peyton, his family, all of you, all of us. Nothing can separate us from that love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Most of all, Jesus himself said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And that next verse is so important. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved.
Amen.
I received a very important phone call, maybe 18, 19, 20 years ago, from our former president at the Children's Home, Dr. Bobby Taylor. And Dr. Taylor invited me to a meal there at the Denny's in Wilson. Had no idea what we were meeting about or were going to discuss, and he came to me and he said, Brother Johnny, I'd like for you to consider becoming a member of our board of directors at the Children's Home, and I'd love for you to be part of the team and serve in leadership. So after a time of prayer that I had and naturally conversation with my wife Donna, I might as well say we accepted this humble place of service within our beautiful denomination. And we promised him to do whatever we were asked to support the children at the home, to help each one of them have an opportunity in Christ to rewrite their story. Years later, 18 or 20 years later, I had no idea the personal and professional profound impact this decision has had on my life, my ministry, and I thank God for this open door of opportunity to serve him every day. And one of those blessings that came from that phone call and that meeting and this open door of collaboration in Christ is to have the opportunity to serve our Lord with our current president and CEO, Gary Lee. And from those years back to the occasion now which breaks our hearts, Gary, you're more than just a colleague. You're honestly one of my best friends. Gary and I spend a lot of time together. Now in my role as board chair and being on the board for a long time, we talk about the children's home and we meet and we share. Our board gets in the room, we pray, we go through important decisions. But I want you to know there's a lot of time we spend with Gary, the staff, and all the families in fellowship. And it's one of the great benefits and joys of serving there at the children's home. And through that process, you know, I met Gary and then I met Janet. And then I met little Peyton and little Ray. I watched the Lee children grow up into the fine young people they are today. We're proud of Peyton. We're proud of Reagan. I thank God today for their faith in Jesus. I thank God for their love for the gospel. I thank God for their love for the church. And I thank this family's love for the original Freeman Baptist denomination. And I thank them for their commitment and their excellence, these two kids, to academics and to friendship to so many people. I have so many memories of Peyton today, and even his recent days in college at University of Mount Olive. I would have to tell you today that, in my opinion, Peyton was a man of style. He would be a modern-day Ric Flair right now. Woo! is a sharp-dressed man, isn't he? I tell you, he had the sharpest clothes and those hats. And every time I saw him, he was wearing a different pair of shoes. He had all big feet. But this young man, he was full of wit and laughter, but he was full of determination to succeed. He was a fine Christian man. Gary, I don't know if you remember, a few years ago, you and I were talking one day in your office there at the children's home, and we were talking about Peyton graduating from high school and heading off to college. And Donna and I have been there 11 years between our Matthew and Morgan now, but we have 3 bachelor's degrees and 2 graduate degrees between our two. And Gary was talking about, well, how am I going to pay for this? And how's this going to happen, Johnny? What do I need to do here? And I felt like a father figure, Gary, and I was happy to do that the days we talked. Even Donna and I had the pleasure, if you remember, meeting you guys one day, one time after worship one Sunday over at the Cracker Barrel. And Peyton was talking about his life and where he was in his studies at the University of Mount Olive. He was excited about the journey ahead, but he had some questions about things and where he was going. And I thought about it. What a blessing. What a blessing. This family, the love they have for each other, the care, the concern. And Gary and Janet, you are to be applauded for bringing up your children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord.
Amen.
I thank God today that you follow the words of Joshua. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Amen.
You called me back at the beginning of the year, Gary, and you said, you know, Peyton's looking at an internship, Johnny. I mean, he's going in agribusiness. Do you have any way to connect Peyton with your son-in-law, Bailey? And Bailey's here today over another room, and Morgan's husband, and Bailey works right down the road here at Meharry. So I had an opportunity to connect Gary and Peyton to my Bailey. And Bailey and Peyton worked for Bailey this past summer in his internship. And everyone at Meharry spoke so highly of how great a job he did in their agricultural and chemical company. All of you know he had an infectious smile. He had a glowing personality. He was larger than life. His character was good. He's a friend to so many, which is so evident by all of you being here today. And as Pastor Allen has said, so many have just outpoured their love over the last few days over at Hockaday Road. Let me encourage us. That love does not need to continue. It does not need to stop. It needs to continue. We all get tongue-tied at times. That's what I get for mentioning Ric Flair in the worship. This family is going to need our love and support after today. And we need to continue to pray for them. We need to continue to hold their hand. And we need to continue to be there one for another. His legacy and kindness and concern and love is going to carry on. There is a bond and a connection that Peyton had with so many. I thought about it. This is a brotherhood. And all of you ladies and gentlemen and students and friends that are part of the brotherhood, you need to keep that brotherhood going. Peyton loved Jesus. And I want you to know today, Jesus loves Peyton. And I'm confident as I stand here today, just as Paul was, to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord. Because when he breathed his last breath, whatever time it was, Friday, when he breathed his last breath here, he breathed his next breath in the presence of Jesus. What happened Friday, my friends, is not God's fault. I want you to remember what Jesus said in John 10:10. The thief comes not, but for to steal, to kill, and destroy. The thief. But Jesus says, I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly.
Amen.
I get it. These events break our hearts. But I want to assure you today, my friends, of these words. If we pause just a moment to think, then we'll have cause to be grateful to God for giving to all of us the beautiful life of Peyton Lee. Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians chapter 1 these words, Blessed be God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies, the God of comfort, who comforted us in our tribulation that we may be able to comfort them which are in trouble by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted by God. Now, what does all this mean? Let me unpack it real quick. God is so many things. He's indescribable. He is amazing. He is the way maker, the promise keeper. He's the light in your darkness. He's the light. He is the way. Our Father is the Father of Jesus. He's the Father of mercies. And He's the Father of comfort. And my friends, He comes to offer you this comfort today from your tribulations, your problems, your troubles, and difficulties in life. The comfort to bring you encouragement and strength and reassurance and hope for today, tomorrow, and forever. No matter the setback, no matter the trial, no matter the heartache, the shock, and even death, God's grace is sufficient. And His comfort is here right now to help you going forward and help you in years to come. This gift of comfort God gives to you. And now you and I will share it with His family. We'll share it with each other. And we need to share it with the world because all people need Jesus. We sing this beautiful hymn in the church, Sheltered in the Arms of God. And those storms rage high, and the storm clouds rise. But I'm here to say today, God will protect you. He is your shelter in the time of storm. So pray hardest when you think you have no words in which to pray. Never forget that God knows about every inability. He knows about our weaknesses in this room. So give your life personally and fully to Jesus. Don't wait. Don't put it off. If you don't know God in Christ, and you've never surrendered to Him and asked Jesus to forgive you of your sin, and you've never repented of your wrongs, do that today. You see, at the end of the day, there is no problem that's too big for the grace of God. And the love of Jesus is unconditional, and He is ready right now to comfort you. Family, I love you all with my heart. And my heart breaks and hurts for all of you. And I encourage us all to trust in Jesus, to hold tight to each other, to have faith in God and make Jesus your Lord and personal Savior and live for Him. And as you do, God's showers of blessings will overflow you with grace and truth in the good and the difficult moments to carry on. Pause, think, and be grateful. We thank God for Peyton. We thank God for being our Father. We thank God for His Spirit to comfort and guide and support. We thank God for His Son, in whom we can find peace and hope and mercy and grace and everlasting forgiveness of our sin. We thank Jesus for His love that's unconditional, generous, and passionate. A love that's amazing and everlasting. Let me close as I share this poem. Comfort for your sorrow, courage for each day. Strength to face this journey, His word to light your way, His peace to fill your heart, although you may not understand, and His love to hold you gently in the hollow of His hand. Let us pray together. Father God, may your blessings of comfort, mercy, and grace, and amazing love fill everyone, now and forever. For those that may be listening or watching today that have never made their profession of faith in Jesus, may this be the moment in time that they confess and repent of their wrongs and do as Peyton has done, and that is to make a profession of faith in Jesus Christ as Lord. Thank you, God, for being so forgiving. Thank you for being so compassionate and kind. In the times we all mess things up in life, even this pastor. Thank you, God, for your grace and your mercy. Lord, be with this precious family. Be with all the many friends. Comfort, sustain, and bless now and forever. In the precious name of Jesus. And everyone said,
amen. If I surveyed all the good things that come.
Come to me from above. If I count all the blessings from the storehouse of love, I'd simply ask for a favor of Him beyond mortal ken. And I'm sure that He'd grant it again. I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven.
We've got some special friends that would like to come forward and make some comments. And after they get through, we will give anyone that's in here in the congregation an opportunity to like to be brief, please, and make comments. That we'll have those after all the ones that are special friends right now.
Explain my relationship with Peyton, but it would take me all day. So I'm just going to read y'all some of the things that I wrote for him. When I was asked to speak, I said no. I was like, no, I can't do that. But I know he'd do it for me. So y'all just have to bear with me. On Friday morning, when I found out, I wrote this for him. And I didn't think I would have the right words to write for him, anything for him, but it came to me and I just knew what I needed to write. So some of y'all probably seen this on Facebook, some of y'all probably haven't. I wrote, never in a billion years did I think I would write this post. Sitting here on his back porch, mourning the loss of my best friend. That's going to do a shoot. Oh God, here I go. They be laughing at me. I spent a few days short of 19 years knowing him as my brother. I learned from him almost everything I know. Though we argued 99% of the time, I wouldn't trade the precious memories we made together for the world. He was my best friend, my partner in crime, my good time buddy, but most importantly, my big brother. He never left or hung up the phone without telling me he loved me. And this morning, as I was trying to wrap my head around this nightmare, I thought of how he always Snapchatted me every morning. I went and looked at his name on Snapchat, and I realized that we had had a 1,214-day streak. For the past 1,214 days, I talked to him every single day. My heart shatters to know I won't be able to call, text, Snapchat, or just ride over to see him anytime I want like we always have. I struggled this morning knowing I would write this and was worried I wouldn't have the right words, but I realized there are no words that can describe my love for him and how much I looked up. Though our hearts break down here, I know he is walking the streets of gold with our Lord and Savior. The Meadow Lights, Alan Jackson songs, Ronnie's Country Store, the Super Bowl, New Year's Eve, Surf City, watching cooking shows, the back roads of Four Oaks, Christmas time, singing Will the Circle Be Unbroken, Craigmont, or simply walking into our church would never be the same. Those are just a few things that we always do together. But I promise I'll always save a spot for him wherever I am. It's been the biggest honor of my life to have known him for as long as I did. If you knew him, you knew true love. He never failed to show his passion for the ones he loved. Peyton Isaacly, I will never understand why this happened or why we couldn't have more time with you. You were supposed to grow old and ornery with me. But you never knew and never will know the love I had and always will have for you. You were my hero as we grew up, and I will always look up to you. You always, and I mean always, told me how it was and never held back even if you knew it would make me mad. But I always made sure I gave you the same in return. I used to get so ill with you for being so protective over me, especially when it came to boys. All the many secrets I told you, as well as the ones you told me, will never leave me, I promise. I promise to be there every step of the way for your family, which has always been my family too. And you always made sure that I do that. I have no idea how I'll go on without you a mile down the road from me, but you will always live in my heart. And I can't wait to stroll over heaven with you. So glad, Daddy. As long as I'm living, my big brother, you'll be. I love you forever. In blood or not, he was my brother, and I will miss him every day until I get to see him again in heaven. Hashtag born to boogie.
Him is to love him, and I loved him dearly. Peyton, you have always been a rock in my life, and there aren't many memories that you're not a part of. Growing up with you has been a blessing and a privilege that I am forever grateful for. I have never known the love from a best friend like you. Peyton was a big goofball, and I love that about him. And so many people have talked about the Born to Boogie side of Peyton over the past weekend, which always made him light up and be the entertainment of any room he entered. But Peyton was so much more. Aside to Peyton, that not everybody had the opportunity to know, but I'm so thankful that I did. He was truly the most loving, caring, emotional, and sweetest guy I have ever known. He cared about his family, friends, and church more than anyone I had ever met. He loved with his whole heart, a love so deep, some will never experience. I'm so thankful that I do. There are so many memories that I could talk about, but just for a little while longer, I want those memories to be mine and Peyton's. Something I would like to touch on, however, is Peyton's testimony and his love for the Lord. Peyton was one of the most unashamed Christians I had ever met. He loved the Lord and would absolutely tell anyone about his Savior or where he went to church. Peyton had his flaws like all of us, but he was such a devoted Christian. If there was a church event, Peyton was there. If the church grass needed mowed, Peyton mowed it. If we wanted donuts at Craigmont, Peyton went and got them. Peyton watched Mr. Cecil and Mr. Gary so closely when it had anything to do with the church. He made so many mental notes so that he'd get every step right for the church, no matter the task. Peyton always imagined he would follow in their footsteps and help lead faith in any direction the rest of his life. He would talk about stepping into their roles and how much he looked forward to being a prominent leader of our church. Over the past weekend, I've had the privilege to flip through Peyton's Bible. A page and a verse he had marked was from Preacher Alan Wayne's sermon back in February. The verse reads, "And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house," Acts 16:31. This is how I choose to remember my Peyton, with the strongest of faith to last generations. Peyton gave the best hugs, had the sweetest smile, and never hung up the phone without telling me he loved me. I know you are walking the streets of gold with Jesus, and probably Preacher Donnie, because you missed him so much. But as we mourn you, I take so much comfort that you are smiling forever in the presence of our Lord. Because how selfish of me to ask you to come back now since you've seen the wonders of heaven. Peyton, you are a best friend that my heart will forever long for. Peyton, I'm so thankful I got to know you and be your forever lifelong bestie. I will always love you and will forever miss you.
As many of y'all know, I'm Peyton's sister. But I wanted to start this off by saying thank you. Thank you to everyone for everything that y'all have done for us in these past few days. But most importantly, I wanted to say thank you to Peyton for being the best brother someone could ask for and for being one of the best people I've ever known. On September 16th, 2022, my world changed forever. I lost my brother, my gym session buddy, my other half, and my late night chat partner. But most importantly, I lost my best friend. We were supposed to see each other get married, see each other's kids grow up, and then finish growing up ourselves. But we can't do that no more. At first, I didn't want to believe it. I didn't think it was true. But all that suddenly came to reality. I've experienced more things in these past few days that I never thought I would have to do. But I don't want to sulk and be sad right now. There will come a time for that. But I want to talk about the happy times because I know Peyton would hate it if I stood up here and talked about all the sad stuff. Growing up with an overprotective big brother was definitely something, but I wouldn't change it for the world. Even if it did feel like he had eyes on me wherever I went. He was crazy, but I loved him to pieces. Peyton was definitely a person you could easily walk up to and talk to him. He would talk to you like you had known him for years. When I think of him, a few words that come to mind are funny, caring, Alan Jackson loving. But I would like to share one of my favorite memories of him. To set the scene for you, it was around 8 o'clock at night before he was supposed to leave for Mount Olive the first time his freshman year. He told me that he wanted to go for one more ride around Four Oaks before he went off to school. So naturally, I asked if I could go with him, and of course he said yes. So we were just driving, talking, and listening to music. And so, by John Michael Montgomery came on, and we absolutely belted out the words, to the point where both of us were struggling to breathe. And right as the song ended, we pulled into the driveway of the house, and we just kind of sat there. And he just looked over at me, and he said, "I'm going to miss this. And this is forever going to be one of my favorite memories of him. And I will forever cherish it." There's very few things that's bringing me comfort right now. But the one thing I know without a doubt is the glorious place that he's in right now. I know that heaven gained one heck of an angel. And I can just imagine him sitting in the recliners watching Westerns with Grandpa while cracking open a Sunkist. I know that he was welcomed with open arms by Grandpa, Preacher Donnie, and Aaron. And I know that they are all rejoicing together. I will never understand why this had to happen to you or why you were taken away so soon. You were there for me since the very beginning, and I'm glad I got to spend these past 16 years with you. Even though we may have fallen and played around, We shared many hardships and many, many laughs that I will forever remember. So until we meet again, I will love you always. P.S. Make sure to give Grandpa a big hug for me.
At this time, if there's anyone that would like to come forward and share any kind of comments about Brother Peyton or saying thank you to the family, now is your time to do that. We'd like for you to come. Come on. Well, you can do it right there over here, but they can hear you a lot better from here. And next door, too, if you would, just share anything. If you can, please.
There's so many stories I could tell, but you said it could be brief.
This morning, I had my coffee in a coffee mug that Peyton brought back for me from Mexico. That he went with his dad. Peyton helped build a home for the Navy in Mexico. It's just little things like that, that every single one of us in this room, like, our lives have changed forever, and we'll, in the daily rhythms of our lives, remember him in little ways, but they're really big ways. Of the 13 years that I taught Sunday school at Faith Freeman Baptist, I had the honor and privilege to teach Peyton for roughly half those years. And we had some special moments in the walls of this Sunday school rooms, didn't we? Our church future has changed forever, but we're going to band together. We're going to do this thing. He was a wonderful prayer. I love to call Peyton to pray. But what I wanted to tell you guys is that he offered up the most prayer requests of anyone. There's so many people sitting in this room that I heard your name in a prayer request. And you guys probably never knew he was praying for you. But Peyton lived his life with such a testimony outside of just what he said every day, right? You know, you don't have to look at somebody and say you need Jesus to keep your testimony. But what makes Peyton so special is he looked at you and said, you need Jesus. He was just that guy, and you took it. And with that being said, I know that he has planted seeds in souls out there. And I just pray that on this side of heaven, we get to see those seeds flourish and come to know Jesus as their Savior. But what I want to reassure everyone today that I know, if we don't get to meet those souls ourselves on this side of heaven, Peyton gets a first row seat. Scripture tells us that the angels will rejoice. So when those people get saved, the angels will rejoice and Peyton gets to be right there to see it. He wouldn't trade places with us.
Anyone else?
Hi. My name's Cameron. And a lot of you in this room probably don't know me. And I don't know you. But Peyton is one of my oldest friends. One of my greatest friends. And he's not just my greatest friend because we talked every day or saw each other every day. Because that's not all that a friend is. Peyton's one of my greatest friends because he was always there for me, no matter what. I knew he was always just a phone call away, or a text, or Snapchat. No matter how long it had been since I'd seen him or talked to him. And when I did see him, we picked up right where we left off. Some of my greatest memories are with Peyton. And I'm so glad I have those to cherish. And on our side here on Earth, it's really hard because it feels like it's ended. that that friendship is gone. But it's not. Peyton is still my best friend, and I'm still his. We just have a little bit more distance between us. And I know that if I ask Jesus, he'll make sure he tells him, hey, for me. And I miss him. So, please keep in mind and remember that your friendship with Peyton is not over. It's just a little bit more long distance.
Don't look at me, Miss Emily. Wow. My name is Wyatt. I went to school, Precious Days, but Camp Peyton. I only saw him a couple times a year, if that. Anyway, I'll tell you something. He was one of those faces you look forward to seeing on a bus every year. One of those people who, he was the same to everybody he talked to. And I'm going to tell you something. I have some of the fondest memories of him at camp. We, down to towel fights in the dorm. He left a will on the back of my calf. I'm not kidding you. If I'm lying, I'm dying, as they say. 3 weeks, that well was on the back of my leg. I ain't never been hit so hard with a wet towel. He loved to pour a bottle of cold water in on you while you're taking a shower. I mean, you name it, he did it. And he was always behind it, but it was always in good fun. Always in good fun. Being up there on that mountain, some of these folks you see back here, cold back here. Peyton was kind of the glue that held a lot of it together. He always had such a good spirit. I love doing, we did, in the mornings, we had devotion every morning that normally a group of us would get up there and do. And I used to love hearing Peyton read the Bible. He loved the King James Version. We always talk about that. He had that King James Version Bible, as we always say. But we hear the read for that and stand up there at some of the chapel services and singing that Cragmont song. He was the loudest singer up there. Absolutely, without doubt. But then I look around here and see how many people knew him other than those who just went to camp with him. It's just a handful of people in the grand scheme of things. And then some of you going to church with him, your family, your college with him, high school, maybe you worked with him. See all the people here, and I hear there's people in the building next door. And just to think that's not even the smallest amount, it doesn't even compare to how many people he touched in his entire life. And I can only hope that I can have the same legacy as him. Because I believe that when each of us have our time to go, Peyton is going to be one of the first ones at those gates, waiting for you to walk through. He hasn't left. This is a goodbye. All right, say goodbye. He's going on vacation. And we're going to meet up with him soon. He's getting all the logistics straight. See him again. To the family, we pray for y'all.
Whatever.
trying my hardest not to cry. But there's no promises. I might need to take a time out. So I met Peyton going to college, and there's many stories that could be shared. But I believe the Lord has led me to say something else. As I've been sitting there, I close my eyes. The only thing I can see is that infectious smile. He was a cheeser. I love to see that smile. When you're down in the dumps, that was the man I would go to. He would always pull me out of my bad mood. You know what Peyton would say right now? Why are y'all crying? He's in a much better place than we are. Everybody here knows he loved Alan Jackson. And there was a song that he wrote, Sissy song. There's a line in there that says, "Don't worry about me." That's what Peyton would be saying. Don't worry about me. I'm just fine. We have to carry his light on and shine just like his smile is shining up there. To the family, we're praying for y'all. And if there's anything you ever need, Mount Olive students will be there for you.
Names are Sonia and Chris. This adult Peyton that we keep talking about is not the child Peyton that we knew as his Cub Scout masters. He was shy and never wanted to come up and get an award. And he'd shake his head at me and say, "No, Miss Sonia, no." And we'd push him. And we hope that Scouts helped him become the charismatic, friendly, outgoing young adult that he has been. We don't go to church with Gang Janet. We raised two boys of our own that didn't go to school with Peyton. But Gina and I were pregnant at the same time with Peyton. And Nathan and Peyton have been the tightest of buddies. For a long time, even though their paths went different ways, Peyton and Nathan had the relationship where you could have not seen each other, they could not see each other for 2 months, and they just picked right up. And it seems like Peyton was with like that with a lot of you too. No matter the time that you have been separated, that he would just pick right back up with you and be genuinely interested in what was going on with you. Some of my fondest memories of Peyton, besides seeing him in a little scout uniform, are the nights when it's 10 o'clock and somebody's driving up in the driveway. And Nathan comes running down the hallway, and I say, "Who's here?" "Oh, it's just Peyton." I'm going to miss that door opening without a knock. And as someone else said, I'm going to miss the hugs and those beautiful blue eyes. I have three other men with blue eyes in my life, and they're all different colors, and Peyton's was another one that was another shade. We feel that, in the words of Alan Jackson, our world has stopped turning a little bit, and we know that that's how Peyton's family feels. But it will keep turning. And as these beautiful young people have said today, we are just a little further away. Chris and I notice I'm the talker. Chris and I want all of you to know that we try. and everybody else in the family, that if you don't know Jesus, and if you don't know him as your personal Savior, today is the day that you form that relationship, because that's what Peyton would want. You open your hearts and you let him in. He's knocking. Peyton never knocked at my door, but Jesus knocked on Peyton's heart, and he's knocking on yours. Any of these men behind me will be glad to talk to you. Even my husband will talk to you about Jesus. Gay, Jay, and Reagan, we love with all our hearts. And I want to echo one last thing, and that is that it's the days to come that are going to get difficult. So we ask that you drop a card. Stop by and walk in without knocking. Keep them in your prayers. And just know that I do believe that the told Miss Susan, Peyton's with James. And to live and die in Christ is gain.
Anyone else? I want to rush you, but you said, I wish you'd give me 5 more seconds. I'm sick. I'll tell a funny one right quick on him, I'll talk to him and we'll move on. I went to see Sister Susan one day, and the protector that he has been talking about, I was on the foot, and he didn't recognize it. So Mr. Peyton came tearing through the back door under the pretense of going to haul trash off. That won't want him to do it. He wanted to know who was coming to see his granny. And when he saw me, it's like he just melted. I think he got an orange crush and just stretched out. That was the end of that story. Anyone else?
Don't touch that stove, it's hot. Anybody ever heard that? You didn't realize it was hot until you did what? Of this group, I'm probably the most common. I'm the least educated, but I'm the best looking. That's my opinion. And my wife will speak with me. Amen. Many thanks to Reverend Dennis Pollock and T's Chapel for having us here today. You see them, you thank them. Thank you for the sound, everybody's work, everything that they've done, use the facilities and whatnot. Gary, Janet, Reagan, I want y'all to know I love y'all with all my heart. All my heart. My heart broken. And I am probably going to be a mess. Where's my actor? Gary wanted me to speak from the heart, and my heart's broken. So I want to say this in preference to anything I say, because my wife would throw something at me if she could. If I say anything that makes this day harder, I apologize. But I remember when our brother Todd and his family, a stupid cat, had scratched his boy, and he wound up in the hospital with cat scratch fever. And he changed his life. And my heart broke for Todd and his family
for his boy. And I remember when we got the call just the other night, and we had to call our daughter, our daughters, and tell them. And Haley cried out, so we spoke a while ago. She said, "No, you just didn't say that. No, you just didn't say that." And my heart broke. And my heart breaks for y'all. You have no idea what it's like. None of us do. If you've not lost a child. I just laid to rest a man in his mid-50s, a little bit older than me. And his mama was in her early 80s. And I told her, I said, his heart just couldn't handle the pressure. He had heart problems and he died. And here in her 80s, imagine what her heart went through. Today I stand before you to tell all of you, even those of you that I do not know, all you tough looking guys out here. Yeah, I've been noticing all of you, and I can't see y'all folks over there on the other side. But I've been looking around. If your heart don't break today, you've got a hard heart. God can't work with a hard heart. God can only work with a soft heart. You see, God loves you with all of his heart. You know how I know? Because his word tells us. It says in John 3:16, we all know it. God sent his only begotten Son to whosoever should believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. But you got to have a heart that can accept that. You got to have a heart that will be open to that. You got to be a heart to say, "Jesus, not my will be done, but yours in my life." And not puff out your chest and say, "I am the leader of my life." Because see, I was in y'all's shoes. I'm just 51 years old. I'm not an old man. Yeah, some of y'all, that's funny. Some of it ain't. Because of how old y'all are. Amen. To my brother-in-law, I'm still a young man. Amen, brother. Some of you guys behind him, y'all think I'm an old man. Let me tell you something. Jesus can't work with a hard heart. He's got to have a soft heart. He's got to have a heart that'll open up to him. He's got to have a heart that will listen to him. He's got to have a heart that you say, "Lord, here am I, use me," and be able to listen. Amen. See, this funeral service here today is because Peyton died, and Brother Pollock, as he was leading us in and said a prayer with us, he said, "This is the strongest man you'll ever meet." I didn't know what the word he was fixing to say. And then he said he lifted 600 people to this place here today. 600. There's about that many. I don't know how many over there. They said this church will hold 450 right here, and there's at least 100 and a half over there. There's a reason Peyton Lee passed away. There's a reason, you see. We may never understand it on this side of glory. But there's a reason. Peyton Lee's life should not and will not be remembered by this one act on this one night which resulted in the cost of his life. It's not how we should remember him. But know this, the events that led up to him losing his life was not a path that any of us need to go down. I don't care how old you are. I don't care if it's legal or not legal. Amen. I want you to know that I love Peyton with all my heart. Actually, Peyton and I are very similar. I'm 51, he's 21. No, that didn't yet. Here it is. I'm 5'7". No, he's 6'3". No. We both wear hats. I call him a hat, he calls him a lid. You know what y'all call hats these days with the flat brims? Y'all know this is funny. I know y'all ain't got to laugh. That's okay. We both wore socks. His were just brighter and more colorful than mine. I guess the best similarity between me and Peyton is this. We both loved the center of attention. And I told somebody at the house the other night, and I can't remember who I was talking to, but my memory about as long as my hair, and I need a haircut. I said, you know, this is negative attention that Peyton's getting, but he sure would love it. Just at Craigmont, just this past week, as the other brothers were talking about, we were doing, was Bible trivia or bingo? Both. It was up there at the front. That was the bingo. Right up there at the front. Facing us. We're out there playing. He's facing us. He just like me. Got to be the center of attention. Got to say something. Got to be loud. Unlike his Boy Scout days. Y'all brought it out on Michelle's fault. He was charismatic. He was loud. He was loving. He was joking. He was lethargic. Come on. Amen. You see me, Craigmont. We all have been in the cafeteria. We've ate breakfast. We're doing the devotion. Here come Peyton. Come on. Amen. He just come dragging in, but he made it. Amen. We'd love to see that smile that's been talked about today. Let me get my message. See, this message is not for Peyton. This message is for y'all. God, Jehovah, Sovereign, His Majesty, Most High, the Holy One, the Creator, the Provider, the Protector, the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, Savior, Jesus, the Word, Holy Spirit, Comforter, Judge. God is omnipresent. He's omniscient. And He's all powerful. He knows all. He sees all. And nothing surprises Him. No one can give counsel to Him. No one can guide Him. God is. He is the great I am that I am. Elohim, God, mighty creator. El Rohi, the God who sees me. El Shaddai, God Almighty. Yahweh, Lord. Yahweh Nisi, the Lord my banner. He goes before me. Yahweh Tisuri, the Lord my rock. All these names and titles, and there are countless, numerous, many more, is how we humanly possible name God. On this side of heaven, we may never know the fullness of God. For we are but just men, made of dust, and to dust we shall return. Made by God, for His purpose, for His will. Man is so blessed if he finds that purpose for his life and does that will of God in his life. How shall we find this, and how shall we find His will? And how do we find His purpose? In the very instrument that God gave us, His Word. For in it we find His will. In it we find His purpose. In it we find the direction for our life, both corporately, as a church, and as individually, as a person. In His Word we find life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Perhaps you've heard that before. We also find the aspects of life and death. The Word of God says in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, it's a familiar passage of Scripture with all of us who read His Word regularly. Verse 1 says, to everything there is a season. And to every, let me start over. To everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under heaven. There is a season, there is a time, and there is a purpose. And he lists those. We'll get to that in a minute. The reason that we are here. Who are we that God should be mindful of us? Think about that a moment. Who are we that we should be mindful, that God should be mindful of us? We are but dust. But we are his greatest creation. The Bible says that we are his workmanship. The Bible says that this is why Jesus had to come and to die on the cross to redeem us. I believe that God knows that we are his finest creation, and he did not want to lose it. He loves you beyond all measure. He can create anything, anybody, any worlds, any universe, and start over. But he did not. He decided to send Jesus to redeem you, to buy you back, to purchase you back. From what? From sin. We can't blame anybody for this today. We can't blame Peyton. We can't blame the driver. We can't blame the alcohol. You know who where the lie? Do you know who and where the blame lies? This is Satan. Satan himself deceived this boy into thinking that the best time that he could have was a drink in his hand. Some of you, that's what you look for on Friday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday night. And I might be even talking to church folk. That is not where to find it. To find everlasting joy is in the Word of God.
Amen.
It is in the fellowship of God. It is to walk with God. It is to grab a hold of the Word of God and grasp Him. Let God take and grab a hold of your heart and let Him squeeze it and let Him feel the presence of God in your life. And yes, you will find a tear running down your face because you will realize how much God loves you. You see, I say to you here today, amongst my brothers and sisters in Christ, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, and you come to this part of your life where you take your life as God, heaven will not be your home, but yet hell. Place not created for man, see, was created for Satan. As my brother alluded to in John chapter 10, Satan comes but for to kill and to destroy and to steal. I said it out of order, but you know, God loves me anyway. And that's what Satan wants to do to you. See, Satan hates you with every fiber of his being. You know why? Because you can be redeemed. You, brother and sister, you, my friend, you who do not know Jesus, you can say to God, forgive me of my sins. And immediately he will. Amen. Praise God in that hope and in that knowledge. Because in that knowledge and in that hope brings us life everlasting. Amen. My friend, let me tell you, the greatest day you'll ever have in your life is when you accept Jesus as your Savior.
Amen.
You may say, well, hey, preacher, I ain't ready to give it up, brother. I like that Budweiser, yeah. I like that left-handed cigarette, yeah. I like to go out with my friends and party. Listen, I've been a preacher for 30 years. And if you know me and you ask any of my congregation, I'm just like Peyton. I'm just as crazy as the rest of them. I'm just as loud as the rest of them. I've had the best time living life. Because when you know Jesus as your Savior, praise the Lord, you can live life then. You ain't got to find it in the bottom of a bottle. You ain't got to find it in the end of a lighter. You ain't got to find it in the needle in your arm. You ain't got to find it in the wild women and the pleasures of the flesh of the world. You find it in God. Because in God, you will find your presence. In God, you will find your purpose. In God, you will find the reason that you were made and that you can be fulfilled in God. Because God loves you. I can't tell it no better than that, brother. I've taken up my time.
I didn't look at my notes, but there's a reason you were made. The time is now. And you need to find your purpose in God and do it. See, Peyton chasing that good time. Man, I can't say nothing, man. I was the same way. Raised in church. I got out of my mama's apron strings, and buddy, I went stupid crazy. I'm just glad God kept me. For some reason, it was time for Peyton to go. And I think that reason is for this time, for this day, for all of you to be here. What better testimony would you give to Peyton if you gave your life to God today? Huh? If not today, very soon. Don't let that time slip away from you, my friend. May God bless you. I love every one of you. And as a song read or sang, I want to stroll over heaven with all of you. One day.
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? Soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb.
So I'm going to ask you, if you will, to stand with me for just a moment. Peter, you have rested. Now you need to rest your backside for just a minute. I'm going to share one verse of scripture and then have a short word of prayer, and then we'll let you all sit back down. This verse of scripture that I'm going to share with you, you've already heard several times today. I was kind of thick growing up, going through school, and repetition was what I was taught to help you learn something, so maybe repetition will be a blessing to us today. The verse that I want to share with you is one I think to be, one many think to be, one of our Lord's most important statements. And it goes simply like this. From John's Gospel in the 3rd chapter, in the 16th verse. Jesus said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Will you pray with me? Father God, we thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you, Lord, for this place. We thank you, Lord, for, in a sad type of way, we thank you, Lord, for this occasion that has drawn us all together in this afternoon. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the presence of the Holy Spirit in this place this afternoon. And we thank you, Lord, for the power and might and glory and truth of your wonderful word. And Father God, in that word you have taught us, Lord, Isaiah 55 and verse 11, that word of yours, as you send it out, that Lord, it will not return unto the void. And we pray, Father, this afternoon, Lord, as your word has been preached, Lord, as your word has been sung, Lord, as your word has been lifted up, Father God, may you honor your word and may it not return, Lord, unto your void. Father, we just pray, Lord, that you would minister. Father, if there be souls here today lost and undone without Jesus Christ in their life, may today be the day they would say yes to Jesus before it's everlasting too late.
Amen.
Lord, if there be that one here today, if there be that one here in this hour, Lord, that is that wayward traveler is the prodigal, Lord, may they see the need to rush quickly home to the loving arms of God. Father, we ask just now, Lord, that you would strengthen us for that which is before us, for that which you have called us to. Lord, may we be, Lord, the vessel that you would have us to be. May we speak your word truthfully and boldly, and it may be that which is pleasing to thee. Minister, Lord, as only you can, lead and guide and direct. And we'll be ever mindful to give Jesus Christ the praise and honor and glory. For it's in his precious and wonderful name that we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Just a very little bit, because it's not about me. It's not even about faith. It's about Jesus. And so let me share with you that I am Pastor Chuck Olds. And I love young people. I vaguely remember being a young people. But I love young people. And so for many years, one of the ways that I was blessed and honored to be able to serve our Father was as a director of care. And I directed young people's Bible conference at Cragmont. We met the last full week of July every year. And we had a lot of young people through the years to assemble on the mountain. And through those years, we tried to teach them Jesus. We tried to share with them those things that were wholesome, those things that were good, those things that were important. And those that really loved it, they came back year after year after year after year. And I want to take just a second now to say to my Jesus, thank you, Jesus. But one of the greatest blessings in my life has been the opportunity that I have had to see more, as I did it for years, to see more than a generation of young people grow up. Boy, how wonderful that was. So that's enough about me. It gets us to where we need to begin to go. I remember one night a number of years ago, we had to preach in service, and we got to the end of the service, and the invitation was given. And young people began to fall out of the, into the aisles and down to the altar. And the altars were full, and the aisles began to fill as well. And I got to looking around, and I got to noticing there were more people on their knees and on their face than there were in their rows and by their seats. And I looked, and I noticed one of those young people is a boy. Every year I would like to have opportunity to witness to some of the kids, share Jesus with some of the kids, and have opportunity to win some of the kids to the Lord, but I also stood back a lot because I wanted the counselors, I wanted to have my co-workers in Christ to have that opportunity as well. Because I want to teach something this afternoon. For those of you who are in Christ, and for those of you who are in Christ and have led another soul to Christ, you already know these. There's only one thing on planet Earth better than leading a soul to Christ, and that's your own salvation experience. It's the only thing better. And so I stepped over and I knelt down, and I began to talk with that boy. I didn't know that boy at the time. I knew his dad. I had known his dad for years. But I didn't know him at the time. And we talked a few minutes about Jesus, and I shared with him John 3:16. On that altar, on that hill, in that mountain, on that wonderful, glorious knock, that boy, who I imagine you know, that boy, Peyton Isaac Lee, gave his life to Jesus.
Amen.
So I want to tell you something this afternoon. Peyton's okay. Peyton's okay. As a matter of fact, Peyton is better than okay. Peyton's great.
Amen. Yeah.
Peyton is great. And you know something else I bet? I bet he doesn't even have a hat on. I've sure seen some of those. I've seen some of those socks. He has brightness.
I've seen that smile. I've seen those eyes. I've seen all of those things. I saw that compassion. And I watched him as he grew. And I got to share a week a year with him. And one of the things that it was kind of unspoken, but one of the things that we tried to do of those that came and stuck and those that went for years and years, we tried to do our part in 4 days and 4 nights time. We tried to do our part in what we could to help them to grow and to help them to learn about the things in life that were important and about the things of Jesus and about the things of soul safety and soul security. And so as they would continue and as they would grow, one of the things that we worked at doing was that our boys, as they became big boys, I would put more responsibility on them. And after that first year that they would have opportunity to do it, see, the girls, we didn't have the girls to move their luggage around the whole lot when we first got pregnant. And after I would say something to the boys the first time, from every year after that, they knew. They would go down to that bus. I'd say it anyway. But they would go down to that bus, and they would get that luggage out, and they would help them girls. And I would tell them, I said, boys, this is the only time this week I'm going to see any one of you on those floors. Until the end of the week. Girls, we wanted to help them to mature. And we wanted to help them to become young ladies because we knew that there would come a time that they would be examples in their community. And so that brings us back to that young boy on that altar that night. He was one of the ones. He was one of the ones that stuck. As a matter of fact, if he'd lived and I'd led him, he'd have went till he was 30 or more. He loved camp. He loved being there. He loved the fellowship. And I got to watch Peyton as he grew. And every year, he would be a little bit more grown. And I don't mean in stature. Every year he would be a little bit more grown. And I could see the maturity beginning in Peyton. I could see Peyton becoming a young man. I could see that he had thoughts and that he had ideals and that he had things that mattered. And Jerry, after I left the other day, I thought about part of our conversation and I remembered, I've heard Peyton say that exact same thing. Richard, what you talking about? Gary and I were talking about times that a father and son would sit down and converse. And Peyton was never the strongest in the world in the area of patience. They would talk and they would have their conversation, and by the end of the conversation, Peyton would be just boiling in it almost. And he would look at Gary, and Gary said, and he would say, Daddy, they just need Jesus. They just need some Jesus. And I was riding back toward home, and I remembered I heard that same thing. I had heard him say the same thing. And so now, here is where we begin to change direction just a little bit. You see, I watched Peyton that week every year. I watched him as he grew. I loved him. He was one of my boys. And I saw that maturing. And I begin to think in Peyton's case, as I had in a number of others' cases, what could be.
I remember beginning to think about the potential. And the man that would grow out of that young man. And I had fond thoughts there. And then Friday morning, about 7:30, I got a call that began to alter those thoughts. It was Emily that called the house. She told us there's been an accident. It was involving Peyton. And he didn't make it. In my heart, too. Almost instantly, it began to break because my mind began to alter from what would be to what could have been. I want you to understand something this afternoon. When we finish, we're going to finish with Jesus and John 3:16. But for just a moment, I want to move you forward a little bit to Romans chapter 3, verse 23. Well, you see, in Romans chapter 3, verse 23, the Apostle Paul wrote, "All have sinned and come short of the glory of God." And that word "come" in that verse, "all have sinned and come," it means fall. All we have fallen, we have stumbled, we have slipped. Gary, as we talked Sunday afternoon, he said, "We're not perfect." He said, "I'm not perfect." He said, "Peyton wasn't perfect." And he said, "We don't want anybody to have that idea." He said, "We all make mistakes." So I want to tell you this afternoon that a mistake is what has brought us to the place we are right at this minute. A mistake. And I told Brother Gary, I said, "Let me share something with you. And folks, let me share something with you as well. Gary, if you don't mind, I'll share the same thing that I shared with you Sunday afternoon." I said, "The Bible teaches us," the verse I just shared with you. I said, "The Bible teaches us that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now, here's what some of you may not know. As Paul was writing that epistle, Paul was writing to Christians. Paul was writing to children of God. And to children of God, the Apostle Paul said, "All have sinned and come short of the glory of God." You know what? Jesus saved me one day, just like he did Peyton. Just like he did his mom, just like he did his dad, just like he did his sister. Oh, boy. Woo! I like that saved part. Jesus saved us who were saved one day. He washed us. He cleansed us. And so that which is behind us, that which was before, that all of that is under the blood. Why are you worried about that? Amen. Nothing to worry about there. But we still got life to live. And in living that life from time to time, we err. From time to time, we stumble. From time to time, we fall. And sometimes great is the fall thereof. We do. It happens. Now let me tell you something else. It's not a shock to God.
Amen.
It's not a shock to God when we stumble. It's not a shock to God when we fall. You see, nothing is surprising to God. There are things that grieve our Father. But they're not things that shock our Father. For if we believe the Word, if we believe the truth of the Word, then we must believe that God knows all. And if God knows all, then there's nothing that catches Him off guard. Amen? And I believe that. If it's naive, then I'm just naive. But I believe that. I believe that God is all-knowing. Peyton made a mistake the other night. And I want to tell you something about mistakes in life. Mistakes always have consequences. Mistakes always have consequences. Things happen. There are things fall as they fall. And sometimes the person that makes the mistake, and in some ways, it may not seem to affect them at all, but it may affect, in fact, someone else. Or, you know, a mistake is kind of like throwing that rock out into the pond and that little ripple effect. Yeah. And so, yes, he made a mistake. But I want to share something else with you. I want to share with you another very important verse in God's Word, in that same book of Romans, in fact. That same apostle writing, Paul writes this. He said, and we know, hallelujah, we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose. Amen. Listen, church, that's a promise. That's a promise of God, and God has promised us that all things work together for good to them that love God. And I want to tell you something I learned over the last few years about Peyton Lee. He loved God. He loved people. He loved family. He loved friends. I sidebar, and I know you've been here a while, but Gary, you raised an amazing son. You raised a good son. You don't even know where I'm going. Watch this. Did you notice all that they got up here talking about my best friend forever and how every one of them pretty young ladies? He's better than all right. While it is that his mistake cost him, let's just be honest, his mistake cost him his physical life. But because he was under the blood, it did not cost him his eternal life.
Amen.
Because he was under the blood, he is now where most, with all children of God, most long to be, and that is in the presence of Jesus, our Savior.
Amen.
And so then let me talk to you for just a minute or two about mistakes. You see, here's the potential of this mistake. We were told, as was mentioned, we were told a while ago there were over 600 souls here today. That says a lot. That says a lot for the life of Peyton. It says a lot for his wonderful mom and dad and sister. It says a lot for that family. It says a lot for that church family. It says a lot for that community. There was a lot of love, and there was a lot of love for him, and respect is being shown here this afternoon. But now let me share with you this. The opportunity, while it is hurtful, while it is heartbreaking, while it is tragic, the opportunity that is before us this afternoon, church, the opportunity that is before us now is the opportunity to learn from one's mistakes without going through the same agony. You can learn from that. A lot of young people here this afternoon. I want to tell you, I love every one of you. And I want to tell you that you have, as you're here this afternoon, you have heard about a mistake. You have heard about a mistake that turned into a tragedy. But now that you have heard about a mistake that has turned into a tragedy, might I encourage you with these words? A mistake that turned into a tragedy can now become the glory of God in action. Because you see, you have the opportunity to learn from that mistake. You have the opportunity to not make a mistake like that. You have the opportunity to steer clear of that because you have knowledge that it can happen. It's reached out and it has touched you personally. Many, through the actions of one. So then I ask you today, what will you do with that? What will you do with this opportunity? Listen, let me be even a moment more blunt than my brother. One drink and one too many.
Amen.
And I don't have time this afternoon to give you my whole testimony. But that word comes from a former drunk. One drink is one too many. One toke is one too many.
Amen.
One juice is one too many.
Yeah.
If you never put it in your nostrils, if you never put it in your mind, if you never put it in your arm, then you don't have to worry about it affecting your person.
That's right.
One is too many.
Yes.
I want you to understand the bluntness of that. One is too many. If you're here today and you have never experienced or experimented with that lasciviousness, let me encourage you never to experiment.
Amen.
You're the better for it.
Amen.
You're the better for it. A part two to that. If you know people in your life who have, if you know people in your life who you have seen potentially make the same mistake, encourage them. Encourage them not to make that mistake again.
Amen.
Encourage them, don't get in that car. Encourage them, don't leave the couch where you're sitting. Just ride it out. Just ride it out and let it leave your system. Encourage them, don't go down. You know what? Every one of these preacher guys, this preacher, every one of us knows what it is what it was to be 10 feet tall and bulletproof. We all know.
Yes.
We all know. But encourage people. Encourage those close to you in your life. Don't do that. Don't do that. It's for Peyton's sake. Amen. If you see that it's going to be done anyway, and you're there and you're sober, you're there and you're straight, then be a designated driver. Don't let them wander into that. Don't let them step into that. Because then their mistake could have the same result. And folks, I'd like to get back to me for just another second. And I'd like to tell you this. Don't do that. And encourage others not to do that. Because I'm getting weary of standing in this position. It's a hard go. It's a hard go. It's a hard thing. It's a hard thing for me to stand before people that I dearly love and have to show me the truth this afternoon. But I think I would be doing them and the memory of their son and brother an injustice if I didn't share with you that truth. So notice what can happen in life. Yes, just one mistake. Just one. And now that you know of that one, avoid that one at all costs. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We all fall. We all stumble. We all stagger. But because of the blood of Jesus, because salvation is full, and because salvation is free, and because salvation provides that life and life more abundantly that you have already heard about this afternoon, then let me encourage you to something else.
Well, I don't need Jesus. I don't believe in church. I don't believe in this. I don't believe in that. I don't care for this. I don't care for that. Can I very pointedly say something to you? With love and compassion, but blood's the only way I know. With love and compassion, I say to you this afternoon, it doesn't matter whether you believe it or not. God's not any less God. Jesus is not any less Jesus. He is the Savior of all humanity. And if you're here today without Him in your life, He wants to be your Savior. Amen. He wants you to come to Him. He wants you to ask Him, as Peyton did those number of years ago. He wants you to ask Him to forgive him. To forgive you your sin. He wants you to ask Him to come into your heart. You see, Jesus won't come where He's not invited. And He won't stay where He's not wanted. But He wants to come into your heart. He wants you to ask Him in. He wants you to invite Him in. For Jesus loves you. You see, that verse means this. For God so loved the world. You, friend, every you here today, including this old ugly thing here, every you here today are part of the crown jewel of God's creation. Humanity is the greatest part of His creation. And God so loved the world. God so loved you, every one of you here. every one of your relatives, every one of your friends. God so loved you that he gave his only begotten Son. In giving his only begotten Son, the Lord Jesus Christ would endure a life of ridicule, would endure a life of besmirching, would endure a life of scourging at the post, would endure a life of nails at the cross of Calvary and the cross that is dropped into the ground, would endure those hours of darkness, would endure the sin of the world upon his shoulders for that which he did not deserve, so that he could provide for you salvation full and free, because God loves you. God loves us that much.
Yes,
that you should not perish but have everlasting life.
Ever.
There's only one way to have everlasting life, and that is in Jesus. That is in Jesus. So we're going to close. But I leave you with these two thoughts. We all make mistakes. Let us learn from those mistakes. We all err. Let us learn from those errors. And when, as hard as it is to say, when God is graceful enough to give us opportunity to learn from another's error, let us learn from that.
Yes.
Let us learn from that. And secondly, this. Jesus does not want you to leave this church, that cemetery, this situation without him in your life. Why did it happen? What is it all for? Why, God? Why? And the answer, or a big part of the answer, is simply this. So more than 600 people in one place at one time could hear the good news and the truth of the gospel. I have looked around this afternoon, and I have seen many of my family. Above me and Shelly are here, and Danny and Seth and Lindy and Emily and get them all back there. And Kayla, there are just many of those counselors that are here today. These three preacher guys that are here today. This preacher guy here today. If you don't know Jesus, reach out to one of us. We want to introduce you to Jesus. We want you to meet Jesus today. We want you to meet Jesus today because there's no greater friend. There's no greater friend than Jesus. So don't leave here, don't leave there without asking Jesus to come into your life. God bless you all. Honor this memory. Honor this time in that way.
Before we have the final prayer, those of Graham Funeral Home has asked that all of you be told that we notice several were parked a good walking distance away from where the procession is and the church and all. They will be giving you extra time if you desire to go to the cemetery, and the services will be concluded there. Don't be in a rush. They will give you adequate time to get to your vehicles and to go with the funeral procession. Also, again, on behalf of the family, on behalf of Rosa Graham Funeral Home, and on behalf of my brothers here, and we want to say a special thank you to Tease Chapel Church and the Reverend Dennis Pollock and all his staff and his members that have worked very diligently that we could have this today. We say thank you to all of them for all they've done, and we say thank you again for all that you've done for the family. Continue most of all to keep on giving your prayers at this time. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Father, again, we come and we call upon your holy name in the name of Jesus. Father, we know today as we've gone through this service now, Lord, that we know that we've come and tried to comfort the family today. We want them to know that Peyton would want them to feel the love from him today and to let them know that it's okay. And Father, to all the people that are here in the sanctuary and all the ones that are in the gym and everywhere else, Lord, that are watching, Father, we just pray that you will just reach down your merciful hand today. Lord, give to them, Father, that opportunity to know the Lord Jesus Christ. That's been the message. That's been the care and the concern of the family today. Lord, that they want to know the Lord Jesus as their personal Savior. Now, Father, for ones that may not go with us to the cemetery, we pray, Father, that they'll just continue to lift this family up. Yes. Continue to be with this family every day in their prayers and thoughts and visits also, Lord. And, Father, that we just pray now that you'll walk with us. Father, walk with all the ones that are here. Father, we pray for your Holy Spirit, that he might today just touch all the hearts, minds, and souls that are here today. But most important of all, comfort the ones who are hurting today during this time, Lord. But most, Father, also touch the ones that are lost here. Everyone's here without the Lord Jesus, Father. We pray that they come to know you before it's everlasting too late. For we ask it in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would everyone except the family, please stand.